The goal of this relatively short lecture is to link sequential convergence to the idea of accumulation points in closed sets. Because as I said in my introductory lecture on sequences in a metric space, sequences are a tool that we can use to try to find topological properties of sets. And in these two statements, what we're trying to link is the analysis of convergent sequences with the analysis of closed sets. So take a moment to read these two statements. They're very similar. So look at what they have in common, where they differ, and then I will come back and prove both of these if and only if statements. Our first statement to prove is that a set A in a metric space is closed if and only if every sequence in A which converges, converges to a limit which also belongs to A. To emphasize here the importance of where the limit lives, consider this set, which is not closed, as a subset of the real number line. I can design a sequence of points, say going to the left, which converges on R, you know, but it converges to a point, that left edge of the interval, which is not a member of the set. So what we're saying is that this behavior cannot happen in closed sets. Let me take a moment to erase this, and then we will come back and prove this. And what we're actually going to do is not prove the statement as it's written. I'm going to prove the reverse. So see if you can write down the rest of the statement. If I started it by saying A is not closed, if and only if, finish the sentence. Okay, instead of proving this statement, what we're going to prove is A is not closed if and only if the negation of the idea that for all sequences you can observe a certain behavior is that there exists a sequence for which you do not observe that behavior. So let me write, there exists xk in A converging to, my notation here is lazy, but that's because this is kind of brainstorming. So there exists a sequence in A converging to a limit not in A. Okay, again, this is not formal writing. That's just me being using shorthand. This is an if and only if statement. I'm going to prove each direction one at a time because for the forwards direction, what I'm going to do is construct a sequence. So assume that A is not closed. And right away, you'll see my motivation for switching to this version of the statement. There's a nice result that you immediately get when you know that you're working with a set which is not closed, and that is the existence of an accumulation point that does not belong to the set. Contrast that with, if I stayed with A, I don't know if A even has any accumulation points. For example, the set of integers doesn't have any accumulation points. But by saying I'm working with a set which is not closed, there exists an accumulation point. I can actually grab one, and I know it lives in the complement. So that's why I wanted to switch. Second remark I'll make before I continue this, and that is careful not to write if A is open. Not closed is not the same thing as open. Okay, so negating the idea that A is closed is simply saying that A is not closed. Okay, if A is not closed, then let me write, there exists X naught in the complement of A with, which is an accumulation point of A. So I will write, which is an AP of A to mean accumulation point or lemon point. What I'm going to do now is manually construct a sequence which lives in A, but which converges to X naught, and that is the sequence that we're looking for. You probably see right away that this is going to be possible because if X naught is an accumulation point of A, but it's in the complement, then no matter like how small my open neighborhoods around X naught are, they're always scooping up points from A. So this ability to kind of scoop up points from A and like shrink the neighborhoods at the same time allows you to create a sequence which is going to get ever closer to A and to X naught and ultimately converge to it. I think I can do this in just one or two lines. Construct a sequence as follows. Choose X sub K. So it's like we're going to select sequence terms one at a time. Choose X sub K. Actually, you know what? Let me just write a little bit better. just want to be pretty good with my language here. For each index k. For each index k, choose x sub k. So that's going to be like the corresponding sequence term for each natural number, to be an element in the intersection of the epsilon neighborhood around the limit, or around the accumulation point rather, of radius 1 over k. Intersect A. Okay, let's pause here for a moment. X naught is the accumulation point. That's what we're hoping to converge to. Because it's an accumulation point of A, it always has non-empty intersection with A whenever I design any kind of open neighborhood around it. So here I'm saying create open neighborhoods whose radii are shrinking in a prescriptive way, like 1 over k, where k is the index in the sequence. Your sequence terms here might not be unique, and that's okay. Sequences don't have to only have unique elements in them. So you might choose the same term a couple of times, but as this radius shrinks, eventually you're actually going to have to pass to a different term. You can't choose the same term forever. Probably think through why that must happen. And we're basically done now. I don't know if I want to leave the reader to finish it, but now xk is a sequence in A because we picked the terms to come from A. So then xk is a sequence in A, and xk tends to x naught, which is not in A, and that's exactly what we wanted for this direction. Okay, I really like this. I like it when I can construct a sequence. So there are moments in real analysis where like the best technique is to build up a sequence. And that in part highlights the beauty of using sequences in the study of topology. So here we created a sequence to show exactly the behavior that we were hoping to capture. The backwards direction is faster. Let me step aside if you're still thinking through this. Otherwise, take a moment and see what you get if you try to go the other direction with this statement, and then I will come back and write that out. The backwards direction has all of the same ideas, but the proof is going to be faster because the sequence is already created for us. So for this backwards direction, what we're going to suppose is that there exists a convergent sequence in A, but the limit is not in A. Then that means that points from A are getting really, really close to this limit. This limit has got to be an accumulation point. Let's just write that out for the reader. Then, straight from the idea of sequential convergence, for all epsilon greater than zero, the epsilon neighborhood around this limit can take the limit out of it. It's not even in A. Intersect A is non-empty because it's got to have sequence points. That was in our study of what it meant to say sequence converged. So this is a non-empty intersection. But now literally the limit X naught here is an accumulation point of A, not in A. So therefore, X naught is an AP, an accumulation point or a limit point of A, but we're assuming it's not even in A. As we found an accumulation point of A in a complement, A is not closed. I switched to this negated sentence, or I negated the original sentence, so that I thought the proof would be easier. Kind of explained that when we did the forwards direction. However, the second sentence that we actually proved is useful in its own right. So the first version of the statement at the very top, what we set out to prove, is a statement about closed sets. That if you have a sequence converging in a closed set, it converges to a limit which also belongs to the set. But this version wasn't just a proof technique. It's also a statement about testing that a set is not closed. It's like a criterion for not being closed. And this could also be useful. So now both of these characterizations tie the idea of being closed or not to the study of sequences in that set. We have a related notion to prove, and then we'll be done with this video. Our last result that we just proved was an if and only if condition for closed sets. In this statement, I'm switching from calling the set A to B because here B may or may not be closed, what we're going to do is close it off. So this statement tells us how to close off a set. Earlier, we said the closure of a set was that set together with its accumulation points, if there were any in the complement. Here, what we're saying is the closure of a set is that set or its potential sequential limits. So it's kind of like recasting external accumulation points in terms of the limits of sequences. I hope that makes sense. So it's like bring in missing sequence limits. Okay, I'm going to prove this, but what I'm going to do is actually two cases because the first case is completely trivial. So let's just remove it from consideration. Proof. If X is in the closure of B, either X is already in B or it's an accumulation point of B in, say, B complement. If it's already in B, there is an immediate sequence in B which converges in B, and that is the constant sequence of X itself. So if X is in B, then like form a constant sequence, you don't have to form an interesting sequence in the right half of the statement. So if X is in B, then you immediately can form a sequence in B, which converges to X. And maybe I should make this an if and only if statement. It's kind of a weird if and only if statement, but let me squeeze the word notice in here and just say. Saying a point is in the set is equivalent to saying the constant sequence of that point converges in that set. Sort of a funny thing, but there it is. So for the rest of the proof, I'm going to assume that X is like an external accumulation point. So it's an accumulation point of B, not in B. Otherwise, if X is in B complement, notice X is in the closure of B, if and only if, because I'm now working with this particular case, X is an accumulation point of B. Let's appeal to the construction that we did a moment ago when we proved the similar statement. This happens if and only if. How about for all indices K, the epsilon neighborhood around X, sorry, I meant to use the same special epsilon, which is the reciprocal of these indices. So I'm trying to erase this. I'm just kind of smearing marker. Let's switch rags for a second. Okay. Take epsilon and give it a prescriptive form. If X is an accumulation point, then any epsilon neighborhood around X is going to scoop up points of B, including of this form. I just realized I'm kind of overusing the letter capital B here. Hopefully it's clear. This is talking about a neighborhood. This is the original set. I'm going to be a little bit casual here and appeal to the previous proof that we just did. So this happens if and only if there exists a sequence X sub K in B with X sub K tending to X. And here I'm going to write C previous proof. Okay. So from here to here, this is the construction that we just did. So we said, hey, if this intersection is not empty, form the sequence by picking points from the intersection and then let K go to infinity, you're going to drive those sequence points closer and closer to this point X, and that's going to cause sequential convergence. Going the other direction, it's like, if there's a sequence in B converging to X, then this must be true because of the definition of sequential convergence. So any open neighborhood you draw around the limit will have non-empty intersection with the set B because we know we have a convergent sequence. Okay, so I was a bit casual here because we just went through this kind of construction, but I think at this point we've got it. So that will wrap up this lecture, where, again, I just wanted to focus entirely in this discussion on the relationship between sequences, sequential limits, accumulation points, and closed sets. These will be tools that we will use, particularly in the study of, say, compact sets. We will need some of these statements here. Thank you for your attention.